Good morning and welcome to episode 53 of the Jaguar Report podcast. My name's Gus Logue. I'm joined by my co-host, John Shipley. How's it going, John?
It's going good. Hey, it's actually morning this time. When you, we're like on like a 3 for 53 rate on that, but it's trending up, man. It's trending up. I'm doing good, buddy. I'm doing good. Thank you all for being patient with us. You know, this episode will come out on Tuesday, you know, every other week, but I had some stuff going on yesterday, you know, that had to really take precedence, but we're here to talk about what was technically a football game on Sunday. Before we get into all of it, it was one of like the sloppiest, like just straight up bad football games. Like the first half, especially, was just bad football. Like, yeah, it was some good defense too, but like there was one sequence. It was like fumble, snap, interception. I'm like, bro, what the hell's going on here?
So many penalties, too. I think the Chiefs had 12. I'm not sure how many the Jaguars are getting. Like, maybe only two. Wow. Chiefs got penalized a lot.
Juwan Taylor got penalized a lot. I feel so bad for Juwan. Like, it basically feels like cops with speeding ticket quotas now. Like, they can't not ticket you, Juwan. Like, yeah. Come on. They got a job to do.
They're just doing what they were told by the higher-ups. But, yeah, it's tough. I feel like being the season opener for, like, the Chiefs' new team and then being in Jacksonville was kind of like a rough start for them. But hopefully they'll kind of take it easy on him as the season progresses.
Yeah, 100%. But, you know, 17-9, Chiefs win. It was a game. It was a game.
Like, I feel like that's how everyone was describing it through the first two or three quarters. It's like, this is just weird. It's not really what anyone was expecting because, I mean, you were one of a billion people who was like, yeah, take the over. Or there's going to be points scored. And again, I don't know. You said it well. It was definitely like good defense being played, but just a weird game.
I was going to say, I did say a lot. All of it ended up being pretty much not true.
I got one of your hot takes written down.
Okay, finally it comes back to bite me.
Yeah,
it comes back to bite
me.
As it should. Well, I mean, okay. Yeah, we'll obviously start with the Jaguars' offense. There's a lot going on. It feels like in 2 weeks, like even like I thought it was noteworthy. The most like noteworthy thing Trevor Lawrence said after the game, and normally in post game press conferences, other than getting answers from a coach on maybe why he did something, which he didn't exactly get a lot of those on Sunday either. Yeah. You basically get like fed jargon, and Trevor Lawrence, like, he's been, you know, media trained since he was like 14, 15 years old. So, you know, he's pretty buttoned up in what he says, but he said, he was like, yeah, even in week one, when we won, the offense just wasn't really clicking, and it's true. I think that, call it an overreaction, whatever. I mean, through 2 weeks, they're, 30th, I think, in EPA per play? And
maybe 31st.
I know they're 32nd in total EPA. I think that's a bit of a flawed stat just because of, the three turnovers. But,
yeah,
it doesn't look much better when you do it like per play. It looks a little different.
And, like, the thing is, there's, like, so many different areas that could get cleaned up. Like, this whole scapegoat thing we talked about last week and, like, or the whole play calling thing we talked about last week. And, like, that might just be a scapegoat situation.
You just pulled scapegoat out of nowhere.
Yeah, I was getting my head of myself in this sentence.
It's okay.
But, like, do you blame, like, the change in play calling? Do you blame, like, the moving pieces in the offensive line? Do you blame, like, Trevor? Like, not that he's been bad last week or the past 2 weeks, but, like, he hasn't been incredible either. There's been a little bit of rust from the receivers. So, like, if you had to, like, assign blame in one area, where would it be? And also, like, before you answer that, like, what's, like, your general, like, panic index level right now? Like, say a 1 to 10 for the offense.
I'd say probably, like, 4, you know? I don't think it's anything really unfixable because I do think, like, just the reality of it, the line will get better in week 5 when Cam returns. I think we all expect Walk a little to move to left guard and, you know, yeah, he's been really good at left tackle. Why would you move him? But either way, he'll be an upgrade at left guard. You know what I mean? So,
yeah.
I, I,
Sorry, go ahead.
And so I'd say a four. And I think like a lot of the offensive issues have been, you know, one, like minute execution, you know, here or there. That's not to say, you know, they'll be fixed, but it's like on a lot of plays that like right there. And I also think things will even out to a sense because, I mean, one, they're still 10th in success rate, which it's crazy, man. Like, you know, 31st in EPA per play, but 10th in success rate. They're still like getting, you know, plays when they need to. You know, they're basically they're moving the ball. It's just disastrous things keep happening to them at one point or another, whether it's a back-breaking turnover or a third or fourth down sack. Like I had a stat yesterday, Anton Harrison's given up. You know, a lot of people look at his first 2 weeks and say, you know, wow, he's really struggling. He's only given up 5 pressures in 2 weeks. You know, there's like, I think 23 offensive tackles with at least 40 pass protection snaps have given up more pressures. Like the Steelers left tackles giving up 15 alone in 2 games, which is crazy. And like Darnell Wright has given up more pressures than Anton Harrison. DeJuan Jones has given up the same amount of pressures and 18 fewer pass protection snaps, but 3 of his pressures have been sacks and they've all been on third or fourth down. So they're like, when he does get beat, it's like one of the worst plays of the game. And it feels like it's that way for the entire offense, if that makes sense. Like, you know, when something goes wrong, it doesn't like go kind of wrong. It's like, Jesus Christ, what the hell was that?
Jamal Agnew didn't just drop a pass. He dropped a backwards pass and turned into a fumble.
They have a problem with that. They have too many. Like, what, Andy Reid challenged that twice or won twice?
Mm-hmm. The whole, like, Agnew gadgety thing was pretty fun last year, but he had, like, one of the highest rates of, like, touches per snap. And crazy. So, like, now that, like, everyone in the league has, like, gotten a chance to, like, see, like, 1 year of Doug's offense, it's like whenever Agnew comes onto the field, there's, like, flashing lights and, like, everyone's like, wee-woo, wee-woo, look at this guy, because he's probably going to get the ball. And so it's just not really working the same this year.
See, he had 35 touches last year on 141 offensive snaps. So
that's like, insane.
That doesn't happen.
That's definitely like one of the league leaders, depending on how you like filter the criteria. But I would say my panic level was like a 2 or 3. I'm on the same wavelength that you are. Where like the offensive line like will get better with the return of Cam, and then just like Fortner and Sheriff getting a little bit healthier, and then like, I don't know about Christian Kirk, but for Calvin Ridley, I'd expect him to like kind of bounce back from the past game. It seemed like the heat might have been getting to him as much as like anyone else. He had two drops that were like tough catches, but he should have made. And then like, I don't know, Trevor just like seemed like he was like forcing passes and like wasn't really like in that groove that he gets in when he's playing really good ball. So that like, again, it's just like a lot of like really small things, and like they're not necessarily going to get fixed entirely or like right away, but it's kind of like easy to see, like literally if Zay keeps 2 feet in like 2 different times, and like we might not really be worried about the offense, but instead they put up the goose egg, which in Trevor's words was like embarrassing and frustrating. So here we are. But like, I think if I had to assign blame to one area for the week 2 game specifically, it would be on the receivers. Because, like, again, like, what do you really expect from a rookie right tackle and then an injured center and right guard against, yeah, as you said, like, Chris Jones, one of the best defensive players of this generation. So, like, that, like, it is what it is. But I think that, like, just slightly better execution from the receivers especially, like, would have been big for the week 2 game, but like whether they can kind of execute going forward is the biggest thing that I'll be looking for.
Yeah, like I thought Trevor was better in week 1. You know, I don't think he was good in week 2. I think he was probably like about average. I mean, there's, you know, the fourth down play when he got sacked by, I think it was Chris Jones, you know, Anton got beat.
Yeah,
you know, it he had Christian Kirk open, you know, and he just double clutched it. And it looked like he let the pressure affect him. Later in the game, a couple plays in the red zone, you know, a play where he could have ran it for a first instead, like you said, kind of forced an inaccurate pass. He missed Ingram on one slant. he had Luke Farrell like open on a incompletion, you know, in the red zone. It just didn't feel like he was as poised and read the field as cleanly as he does, you know, most weeks. And then the deep ball, that one deep ball to Zay Jones, I think was the worst deep ball I've ever seen him throw.
Yeah, but like, did you think like Zay was open?
No, he wasn't open at all.
Yeah, I think it was like almost a throwaway. I mean, that's fair. It certainly wasn't pretty.
I mean, Zay had to tackle the corner. I don't know how I didn't get flagged, honestly.
That's true. There was a lot of like.
Yeah. So. But he also made some really, like that throw to Christian Kirk, obviously at the end of the third quarter was, you know, massive. Those downfield throws to Calvin Ridley, who Ridley, while he didn't have a productive day, I mean, he drew what, two offensive pass interference penalties, which. Like, when teams, like, show they can't run with him, I believe that's just what you got to do. Like, even if it's incomplete, dude, you're getting free yards right there, especially – it seems like they know when the offense is stagnant, that's kind of the will to go to. Mm-hmm. I agree with you. It looked like Ridley, you know, still, you know, looking like he was getting used to things. The play where he got thrown into the goalpost was unfortunate.
Yeah.
That I was surprised he came back in the game after that, honestly. And – Like you said, there was just a bunch of so many like close plays in the end zone where maybe Trevor missed an inch here, or maybe Zay Jones, you know, didn't get a foot down. It was like plays that it looks like the Jaguars make them like 9 out of 10 times, you know, like the Zay Jones, like in the back of the end zone plays, especially. I feel like we've seen them make that throw over and over again. And at some point, it's just not your day. You know, and it felt like that Sunday. So it definitely felt, you know, a little forced at times. And I also think, you know, everybody, like you said, is going to talk about Press Taylor and the play calling. I think the Jamal Agnew gadget play right after fumble, I thought, okay, I think that's one play you can critique.
Yeah.
I thought the Christian Kirk double pass was, you know, too cute. It, like, I don't think you need, you know, gadget plays, you know, like I get what you're doing, you know, you're trying to catch them on their heels and get some momentum going, but at some point you need to just play, you know. Yeah. Especially like you're not starting Marvin Jones anymore, you know, you don't need to trick them anymore, you know. you can just, you know, be a regular offense. And I think, you know, obviously the first and goal, I don't know how to interpret, you know, that first and goal play from the one, you know, what Doug, it seems like it was Trevor's fault, basically, you know. Yeah. I don't know if it was a design handoff or if it was an option, maybe. But
I think it was a design handoff, and yeah. Then he, like, just saw an opening and pulled it, which is the same thing that happened in the Tennessee game last year. And, like, I don't think Doug and, like, the coaching staff is, like, necessarily opposed to him, like, seeing an opportunity and kind of taking it, but obviously it just like did not work out on Sunday because he read like there's two guys that crashed off the edge, so Trevor just kept the ball and tried to go outside. But I think it was Nick Bolton who made just an awesome play to kind of meet him out on the edge.
Yeah, and then Legarius Sneed was like basically playing like linebacker and just flew and, you know, smacked him. And I think when Doug was saying like, yeah, we can put them in better situations, he means maybe just go eye formation and not
get
there, like, you know, the chance like to do something like that, like just hand it off up the gut. So I thought maybe even though it was a call run, maybe it was a bit big brain there just because knowing who your quarterback is and you need to be firm. Like, we're just running this thing. You know, we need a touchdown here, no mistakes. I thought those were the bad moments in the play calling. Otherwise, you go back and watch it, man. A lot of it is just, like, plays are there, and, like, it's, like, one big mistake happening from somebody, you know? Like, I'm not saying that to atone anything because, like I said, the plays I mentioned I thought were bad, and a lot of them came at critical times. But I really think, like, the Jaguars' offense looks a lot like it did last year in terms of, you know, what they're trying to do. You know, I don't think the play calling looks that different, in my opinion. Yeah. And if there was any one major like thing I think they didn't do well, it was help Anton Harrison. And other than that, I think it was most execution. Now, not helping Anton ended up being a big reason they lost. Yeah. So that's not to say it was a small thing, but
yeah,
that's my two cents.
I think that's fair. I feel like a lot of like the gimmicky, cute plays that were called were kind of because of Anton and the offensive line. It was like we want to be able to like drop back Trevor into 3 and 5 step drops like every other play, but like it's just not feasible based on the amount of pressure that Kansas City is creating. So like that's when you see like trying to get the ball out quick to Jamal Agnew in space, and then you see like them trying to have like Kansas City's defensive line right across the field on that double pass, and then that they didn't run across the field, so they were just like right there ready to make the play. So to me, like the offensive play calling showed a lack of trust in the offensive line, but like again, like the offensive line is gonna improve at least a little bit as time goes on, and they're not gonna play Chris Jones every week. I guess like one thing that I'll be looking for in the Houston game is like the big thing is whether they can bounce back in red zone offense, because they were 3-for-3 in week one and then 0-for-3 in week two. So it's like, which version of the Jaguars do you want to be like this year and like improving, or are you going to be stuck in 2022? And then against Houston, like I predicted a month ago, if not longer, that Will Anderson was going to record 3 sacks against Anton Harrison. So what are they going to do schematically to prevent my hot take from?
Will Anderson looks fantastic, and he's probably going to be one of the toughest guys. Like that shows the nature of the NFL. It's like you can't take a breath and be like, okay, we played, you know, an alien last week, maybe this will be easier. Nope. Yeah, Chris Jones last week. Yeah, Will Anderson this week. Yeah, things will get better when you play the Atlanta Falcons, but that's about the extent of that. I mean, back to your receiver point, I agree with you a lot to an extent. I just wasn't as sharp of a game from the receivers. I mean, they had 4 drops. Like Trevor's, I think, adjusted completion rate was like 67% or something like that. So like it, you know, better than it ended up being. And it was 2 drops by Calvin Ridley, 2 drops by Christian Kirk. And I think what kind of goes back to what I was saying, the execution is, you know, all 4 of those drops came on plays where Trevor Lawrence wasn't pressured. So, you know, like these, if you have an offensive line that's struggling, you need to make plays when, like, you know, the blocks are there. And I remember one of the Ridley drops was like, it would have been an explosive play in the first drive. It would have got him what, like the Chiefs, like 30 or something like that. And then Kirk had the strangest 100-yard game I think you're going to see, because it did not feel at all like the impact of the 100-yard game.
Didn't he have like 14 targets or something too?
I believe so.
It's just like you kind of said, like it's about the expectations, because like we talked for like all of August about like how the offensive line might sneakily be a concern, and then obviously some injuries happen, and obviously Cam isn't playing and Anton is in his like first couple of NFL games. So like the offensive line struggles shouldn't be like super surprising at this point in the season, but like Kirk dropping 2 big balls and then like Ridley supposing to be the alpha guy who he's like kind of talking this big game about like how there's no more rush in this game anymore, even though it kind of clearly showed up in week two. And then Zay, like apparently he had a knee injury, or he did have a knee injury and left the game, and so that'll be like a big thing to monitor, because I haven't heard anything about that. But the way Doug was talking about it on Monday was like, it's not like major, but it might not be minor either. But like again, like just those 2 or 3 end zone targets to Zay Jones, like just barely missing. If you knew going into the season that the offensive line wasn't going to be perfect from the start, then you were going to need a little bit more out of your receiver group, even if your main receiver is like new in town. But like, I think if I had to like blame one unit for the loss or for the overall game performance, I'd put on the receivers.
Yeah. So Kirk was 2nd in targets in week 2, 10th in yards, and 28th in yards per route. So it felt like a day, like I think Doug kind of spelled it out last Friday. He was like, yeah, you know, the Chiefs play a lot of man coverage and pressure. We're going to throw it to Christian Kirk a lot, which kind of seems like that's what the Jaguars are going to do against teams like that. Gus, how much of this also do you just tip your hat to the Chiefs? Like, it seems like their defense is legit good, you know?
Oh, totally. Especially on the red zone plays. Like, because yeah, it was like a matter of inches, and like maybe Zay could have gotten 2 feet in, and Ridley, maybe Trevor could have placed it like slightly better. But like all that said, like it was a matter of inches because of like how the Chiefs were playing them. They played lights out, not just the red zone, but like everywhere on the field. I feel like Jacksonville couldn't get the run game going at all early in the game, and then later on they were able to like kind of sort of figure out how to pick up closer to 4 or 5 yard chunks. But man, like they looked good. I feel like usually a Spags defense isn't this like well put together this early in the season, but
yeah,
they looked like the defending champions.
Let's see. So the Jaguars had 13 carries on between the running backs on Sunday, and take away Travis Etienne's, 9 yard carry, and they had 39 yards on 12, other carries. There's just nothing there, for the running game. And the screen game is an extension of the running game too, but they obviously are going to struggle to run it against teams with tough interior and physical defensive lines, which is, what the Chiefs have. And yeah, I'm with you. I thought Spags, like his defense, really brought it. Obviously, not every team has Chris Jones, but most teams have a guy who is, not Chris Jones, but pretty dang good and can hurt you. So yeah, it's worth, watching forward. I think the biggest thing after, watching it again is it does, in my opinion, the play calling looks similar to last year, but it also to me, does it feel like to you like they're trying a million different things and they, potentially just don't know what direction to go in right now? Like, it's week two. I know it's still feeling out for teams, but, you'd expect they would already, be felt out after last year. Does it seem like maybe they just don't know what their identity is right now?
Maybe they're, like, working through it a little bit, but I don't think they're just, like, throwing stuff at the wall and seeing what sticks. Like, it's not that deal. Like, I agree with you that, like, their offense looks very similar to what their offense was last year. And, like in the run game, like, they already had a pretty diverse run game with, like, different types of calls. It's not like they, like, majored in one thing, like, in a wide zone. So when they're, like, doing a bunch of different stuff now, like, I think it's just that they have, like, a pretty, like, defensive playbook. I don't think it's necessarily, like, oh, now that we have Ridley, like, let's try to introduce, like, this, like, whole new thing of concepts. Or, like, same thing with Tank or Brenton Strange. I think it's, like, they like, probably, like, added or modified a couple things during the offseason, but, like, they're just going to do that every offseason. It wasn't necessarily because of, like, any new pieces or Trevor going into his second year. Like, that's where the biggest difference probably would be, is, like, just doing things that Trevor really likes and staying away from things that he doesn't like.
Yeah.
So I think maybe, like, by the end of the season – like, we could kind of see it transform a little bit, and we're like, oh, this is, like, kind of, at this point, a different offense than it was in 2022. But from what I've seen so far, like, they haven't really changed that too much.
That's fair. I'm glad you mentioned Brenton Strange. Their rookie class, like, production on Sunday, where it was, like, Anton versus Chris Jones, Tank Bigsby and pass protection. And
yeah, like, dude, with, like, 2 touches.
Tank had 0.
0 touches, okay.
0 touches, 0 targets.
Yeah, for sure. Wait. Target to him didn't count.
No, because it was a fumble.
Yeah.
Dang right, didn't count. He played like one fewer snap than the week before, so it's not like he even played less. They just didn't give him, the ball. And I'm glad you mentioned Brenton Strange. So far, averaging 6 routes per game.
I think that was my guess, wasn't it? Or you asked me a couple days ago how many – I guess.
I think you said like 10. And he's ran 12. So not saying any picks, obviously bad pickup to week two, especially when, him and Luke Farrell got blew up on one max protection play. But otherwise, you go back, and I thought Strange honestly blocked well. He had a really nice block on Evan Ingram's screen on the first drive. But it does go to show that – maybe they could have drafted for more of an immediate impact, in the second round. But that'll be a conversation, obviously, to be had. Before we break, you want this week's Balky Ball?
That's the first time you've ever asked me if I wanted it. Does my response make a difference?
Since we're on the topic?
Go for it.
Okay. All right. You ready?
I guess.
Okay. Players this year with fewer sacks than Caleb Von Chaisson. Okay?
All right.
With the same amount of pass rush snaps. Okay? Yeah. Sam Williams. Kayvon Thibodeau. Tyree Wilson. Aiden Hutchinson. Odafe Owe. Greg Russo. Sam Hubbard. Nick Bosa.
Oh, wow.
Hassan Reddick. Za'Darius Smith. Preston Smith. And Calais Campbell. Would you rather have any of those players than Caleb Von Chaisson's pass rush production this year? You've been bulky bald.
That was like the gnarliest list ever. It's like Nick Bosa and Calais Campbell? What?
Obviously, like, I think Chaisson has like two pressures and 32 pass rush snaps, but yeah. It's hilarious because you know NFL GMs think about sacks strictly and not pressures. So you know they're shredding their stuff about Chaisson getting a sack against Mahomes.
Hey. If anyone didn't watch it, he went around the world in order to get Mahomes. Like, just
would you rather have Aiden Hutchinson's NFL best 13 pressures or Caleb Von Chaisson's one sack?
Easily Aiden Hutchinson's 13 pressures.
You just got masterclassed, my friend. You just got masterclassed.
All right. I don't – this segment makes less and less sense to me as things go on.
Arden Key has 9 pressures and 3 sacks, by the way.
Yeah, okay, there we go. Masterclass.
All right. We're going to break, come back, talk about the defense.
How many pressures and sacks does Javion Clowney have?
Okay, give me a second. Hold up. I'm working.
We got the guy at the desk. Is that what they call him?
He has 2 more pressures than Trayvon Walker has this season.
Oh, interesting.
PFF also isn't like. It's going to be annoying to me. The rest of the year, you're going to have to look at Trayvon's thing and add a pressure to it. They're not counting, I guess, the pressure from when he drew the hold on Juwan Taylor, because NGS counts that as a pressure, and they have him as a pressure. ESPN apparently counted it as a pressure.
Yeah.
Is big PFF, you know, working for
APFS.
You know, pump up the Aiden Hutchinson stats a bit? No. Aiden Hutchinson has been significantly better.
Okay. We got to get to the defense.
Okay. We'll break and be right back. All right, Gus. As we all predicted through 2 weeks, the Jaguars are being driven by Mike Caldwell.
Mike Caldwell.
He's coaching his ass off, too.
He is. Holy cow. Like, talk about, like, getting the most out of your unit. Didn't really see that. Like, saw maybe a little bit of flashes last year, but there's always that caveat of like the opposing quarterbacks that they faced. And then it's like week one, they come out, perform really well, but it's like, well, it's a first time head coach. It's a rookie quarterback making his first ever start. And he had like not a lot of collegiate starts. So he's a pretty raw guy. So it's like, yeah, the defense did well, but there was still kind of like that asterisk mark. And like, yeah, maybe Travis Kelce wasn't fully healthy for the Chiefs, and maybe they don't really have a true receiving threat beyond him. But, like, you still just went up against Patrick Mahomes and Andy Reid and held them to 20 points, which is incredibly impressive. The Chiefs only scored that few points once last year. They scored 17 in a loss to the Colts in week 3. So, like, it's crazy because, like, we – talked all offseason about like how like, oh, they like lost 2 depth pass rushers and didn't really like get better anywhere in terms of the roster. And the Jags brass is like, oh, well, we're going to see like second year improvement, not just from second year players in the league, like someone like Trayvon Walker's in the second NFL season, but also guys like
Andre Sisco.
No, I was trying to think of like a free agent who signed last year who's going into like their second year as a champion.
Yeah. He mentioned Foyer, Foley.
Yeah. So like guys like that, they were just expecting like their current roster to kind of just like get a little bit better. And like, that's what we saw against the Chiefs. I feel like Andre Sisco has clearly been like the biggest improver. We saw some of that in week one too. And so like he's become like a key impact defender in the middle of the field. And then like now that Darius Williams is starting out the year on the outside as opposed to the nickel, like they really haven't let up a lot, if anything, on like the outside of the numbers between him and Tyson Campbell playing outside corner. And then like Trey Herndon is held up pretty well. He like lets up one or two big plays here and there, but like he makes plenty of plays too. Devin Lloyd still coming along.
I thought like the Travis Kelce touchdown obviously was him like just not being obviously disciplined, knowing that Kelce likes to get off, like when they get off schedule, like don't just sit in your zone. But I thought otherwise when I went back and watched it, honestly, not a bad game from him.
I think it was on the same drive as that Kelce touchdown. It was the one where like Pacheco had the big run to like start the third quarter. That run was not to Lloyd's side, but he like kind of like had an opportunity to like hit a gap, but then he just kind of like stood there and was like looking around, and then Pacheco like beat him outside, and then he like couldn't even chase him down. So like that was like kind of a rough moment on film. But then later in the same drive, the Chiefs ran another like similar looking power play to Pacheco, again going like not in the direction of Lloyd, and then like Lloyd this time just like hit the gap and like made a tackle for loss. And so like even though he's not all the way there yet, like you can see signs of improvement.
Yeah, I'm with you. I do think he looks better than he did last year. He had a nice pass breakup in the end zone against Kelce too. Like I know Kelce wasn't 100%, but dude, the Chiefs still threw to him 9 times. Like if he was, you know, Lieutenant Dan out there and couldn't move, like he wouldn't be on the field as much as he was, and he wouldn't, you know, have gotten the amount of volume that he did. So, I mean, he had 9 targets, you know, obviously caught the 9-yard touchdown, his longest catch of the day. Take away that and 3 catches on 8 targets for 15 yards and like several pass breakups by the Jaguars. I know Rashawn Jenkins had 2. So it was, I thought, as good defensively as they've, like Patrick Mahomes just looked flustered a lot of the time. And yeah. I know that this isn't the Tyreek Hill Chiefs, you know, like Justin Watson, he can fly, but other than the 1 deep catch he had, he didn't really do much.
Right.
I thought this was as good as they've played Patrick Mahomes.
I think like their defensive line was like the standout, partly because like they got a lot of pressures and were able to get him down the ground a couple of times. But like at first I was like, oh, like the coverage is playing out of their minds, because it seemed like a decent amount of coverage sacks where like Mahomes was just kind of like standing pat in the pocket and didn't really have anywhere to go downfield. So then like the pressure eventually got to him. So at first I was ready to like hand the award or whatever to the secondary, but even though the secondary did play very well, also like thinking back on it, like I think the Jags just did an awesome job of kind of like collapsing the pocket, but not like too quickly. They just contained Mahomes like better than I've seen them contain any quarterback in Mike Caldwell's tenure. And like, I feel like Mahomes had like 2 scrambles for 15 yards and like 1 first down, and that was it. So he's like such an underrated scrambler, because like even if he doesn't actually pick up yards, then he'll do a ton of damage outside the pocket. And I feel like he really didn't do like any damage outside the pocket.
Not really, dude.
So like hats off to like the coverage, the defensive line for playing good contain and then getting home, Mike Caldwell for putting the whole thing together. It was a really impressive showing.
I thought, honestly, like the pass rush, I didn't think was as good as maybe it needs to be. But like you said, the containment was, to me, the best they've ever had against Patrick Mahomes. Because that's always what they struggle with against Patrick Mahomes, in my opinion, especially last year, was they just, like, they could get an initial pressure, but they could not contain him, like, to save their lives.
Yeah, they got, like, plenty of pressures in the divisional round, especially, but, like, then just couldn't bring him all the way to the ground. So it seemed like it was I'm sure they, like, tried something similar last year, and then it just, like, they ended up being able to execute it better this time around. But yeah,
that's fair. It didn't seem like a much different approach than what they had last year. I'll give you that. I mean, you know, you mentioned, I think Andre Sisco has been, you know, arguably the best performer on the defense through the 2 weeks. I mean, he has one interception, one forced fumble, two pass breakups. I think he's been, like, undeniably, like, elevated his game to a level. Like that interception he made, when you see, like, the wide replay of it, the whole field, it's insane. It is – the range and play speed is crazy.
Yeah, it's a too high safety look, and he's on the shell that's, like, not covering the deep ball. And then he kind of, like, flies over, which, like, maybe that's kind of sort of his, like, jurisdiction or, like, area he should have been, like, helping out in. But, like, I don't know. It seemed like he just, like, made an insane play.
Yeah, it really was. And I think, like, just the secondary just looks more in sync to me. You know, it looks more gelled together. And other than obviously getting beat on, I think it was, like, a vertical route from the slot. You know who had a good game?
Trey Herndon.
That's right.
Yeah. There was the one out of the slot, which, like, it was a perfect ball and, like, pretty good defense. So, like, that one was just, like, kind of like a what are you going to do, in my opinion. And then Herndon also had a missed tackle in, like, the second quarter on, I think it was Justin Watson again.
I think it was Pacheco.
Maybe it was Pacheco. Maybe we're thinking of two different ones.
They had 12 missed tackles.
Herndon, like, missed this one tackle that would have made it, like, 4th and 9, but instead he missed a tackle and the Chiefs got to, like, 4th and 2. And then, like, 4 plays later, they scored a touchdown. But other than, like, those two mishaps that I can, like, picture in my mind clearly, he had several pass breakups, several big tackles. Like, generally speaking, had a good game.
Yeah, and I had somebody yesterday, you know, tweet at me when I put out a stat about Jenkins on Kelsey, you know, 2 targets, 2 pass breakups. Like, you know, Mahomes still threw for 300 yards with a bad, receiver score, which is, you know, correct, but he threw it 41 times. There's a 54 and a 34-yard completion. Now, obviously, you don't want those, but, I mean, they were just, you know, Patrick Mahomes, you know, what can you do? It was the 11th worst game the Chiefs have had in the Mahomes era in terms of success rate. So, I mean, it was as good, I think, as you can ask from the defense. That's why I also think for a week 2 game, this game was as deflating as it was, because you're probably not going to see the defense play them that well again, you know, if you see them in the playoffs. You're probably not going to get 12 penalties against Kansas City again. You're probably not going to get 3 turnovers again, including 2-1 at the 17 and 1 at the 35. And you're probably not going to get Travis Kelce getting, like, 3 personal fouls, you know, on his own, basically, to advance drives. So, like, you just – and you're not going to get a hurt Kelce, you know, probably again. So, they just aren't going to catch the Chiefs like they were this Sunday again, which, I mean, the last 13 games, they're 9-4. 3 losses to the Chiefs and, you know, 1 to the Detroit Lions. Like, the Chiefs just have the number, you know, like, for whatever reason it is, you know, whether it's players pressing, coaches pressing, which I do think can be a thing, you know, Doug Peterson's 0-3 against Andy Reid. It's like a Nick Saban thing at this point where he owns his assistants. Like,
I think now he's 0-4 against Reid.
Yeah, 0-4, my bad. Yeah, at the Jaguars, you know, the season, you know, goes how they want, you know, over a 17-game period instead of 2 weeks. I don't think they want to see Kansas City in the playoffs. I don't think this is a team that it looks like they can beat. On paper, they should be able to. And obviously any team can win on any Sunday, but it just seems like they play the Chiefs. And it didn't happen to the defense this week. It felt like the defense kind of took last year personal. They played really well, but the offense just got in their own head and just evaporated.
I feel like week 2 was just, like, a test to see where the Jaguars are at in terms of, like, kind of power rankings in the league. It's like, are they, like, a true, true contender, like, in the same tier as, like, the Kansas City Chiefs and, like, the Bills and the Eagles and the Niners and the Cowboys? Or are they, like, still in kind of, like, the tier below that where they're, like, kind of, like, fighting for contention and, like, a clear playoff team but not really in that upper echelon? So, in week 2, like, they failed the test, like, no one's going to announce them as, like, a clear Super Bowl contender now that they, like, lost to a Chiefs team that, like, they had a pretty good opportunity to win. And, like, they're 0-3 in their chances to kind of like pass that test. But like, it, like, it's not that big of a deal to fail that test, because like they still are like in the tier like right below, and they're still kind of like knocking on the door. So like, I think just like in the rest of the season, like with the offensive line like gelling together a little bit better with Cam coming back, and then like Walker getting more experience, Anton Harrison getting more experience, and then on defense, like Devon Hamilton is still kind of come back. Like if Trayvon Walker and Devin Lloyd keep improving like week to week, like maybe they'll end up becoming like kind of like that tier. And then like, I don't know. I kind of think they want to see the Chiefs, because like, even if your point about them like not being on the same level and like not being able to like get it done is true, like I think now they're like going to want to see the Chiefs more than any other team in the playoffs, just to like prove themselves. Cause I feel like a Chiefs win is like, would feel almost as good as like winning the Super Bowl. Maybe not that. Now that I say
that's why you should want, that's why they should want to play them.
Yeah. Maybe it's gotten a little bit too emotional at this point, but I think that's probably, as you said, like they were just pressing so much, like emotion might've been a/the reason that they lost in week two. But I'm just saying, like, I think that like, they'll prove over the course of the season, or at least they had the chance to prove that they are in that like top tier. And like, cause they really haven't played like a fully consistent game, like on both sides of the ball, like under Peterson, I feel like maybe like one or two like big wins against like the Chargers in week three last year, and then like the Texans in week 17. But like, just like, I think like a big test for them for the rest of the season is like, can you like put together consistent games, and again, just like prove that you really should be in contention with the Chiefs.
Yeah, no, I'm with you on all fronts, and I think this Sunday will be a big testament to that. We'll obviously get to that on Friday. The last thing I want to talk about defense, I balky-balled myself. The pass rush plan lasted 6 quarters, I think. That's when Josh Allen got hurt. He came back in the game, but he didn't look – I think all of his – he got three pressures, I think, and two quarterback hits. I think they all came in the first half. So he was dominating Donovan Smith. Then he got injured. You saw Caleb on Chase on play a lot more. Mm-hmm. And it just wasn't, you know, effective. And I know it seems like they're really banking on DeJuan Smith when he comes back, but – I thought this game perfectly summarized why the pass rush, like, you know, was maybe a bit of a question. It's just when Allen went down, they didn't have anybody they could plug in there who could make a play.
Dude, at one point they had number 90 playing on the edge, who is
Angelo Blackson.
And that's not an edge player. Like,
speak for yourself.
I feel like I was just like watching like an even bigger and even slower Dwayne Smoot trying to play edge. There was one side, like, you know how like good both Trayvon and Josh Allen are at being the backside run defender and like just closing that gap. Like, there was one of those plays where he was 90 was a backside run defender, and he was just like jogging to the other side of the formation, or it looks like he was jogging. I don't know, but like I'm with you where like the edge is, the depth is a concern.
Yeah, let me see. They had PFF has him. He played 20 snaps, 8 at defensive left tackle, 1 at nose tackle, 9 at left end, which it could be like, I don't know how to define that, whether it can be a 3-4 defensive end or not, and then 2 at Leo, which I hate that that's in there. So checks out. Yeah, that is. They definitely need bodies back. You know, and if they're healthy, you know, maybe you have Ward, Robson, Harris. You know, do that. But you need them inside because you know they don't have Devon Hamilton. So
yeah,
it'll definitely be something to watch moving forward. Gus, we're gonna take a quick break. Come back with our final segment. All right, Gus. We've put this game to bed, tucked it in. Gave it a glass of milk. The Chiefs game is almost gone.
All right, good.
But we're going to finish off with game balls and hot takes.
Yeah.
Hot takes. I have one I have two cooking, and I got to decide which one to give you. So I want you to go ahead and start with game balls.
Okay. Walker Little gets my game ball on offense just because I feel like he was, like, the most consistent player on offense. He allowed one pressure this past week, or zero. Zero to one pressures allowed. Zero, John.
One in week one.
And one in week one. So one through the whole season. And he's just been, like, the type of consistent that we're looking for. And it felt like he was really, like, the only offensive lineman who had a above average game against the Chiefs. So shouts to Walker Little. And then for defense, I was thinking about Cisco and Herndon, but you just said his name, Roy Robertson Harris. I feel like has been, like, even if he didn't make a bunch of, like, flash plays, like, this is kind of a game ball for the past 2 weeks, I guess. But, like, I think his presence has been, like, a major factor. He's been a major factor in, like, not in Devon Hamilton not being missed too badly, because I thought the team was gonna miss Devon Hamilton, like, not desperately, but a decent amount, just because Ham is a really good player himself. So I think Roy Robertson Harris has done a really good job of kind of, like, helping to fill in that gap.
Yeah, I thought Fuller Fatakasi. Yeah,
true. Yeah,
good 2 weeks. Good 2 weeks too. Yeah. You got a special teams game ball, or are you agnostic toward them?
I mean, Logan Cook had a couple of pretty far punts.
The only player who scored points for the Jaguars, the man.
True.
The man, Brandon McManus. The Manus.
First kick at Everbank Stadium.
Yeah, it like seems pretty clear. Like, what? Well, it was a 49-yarder that they just trust him more than they ever trusted Riley Patterson. So I'm with you. You know, game balls on my end, I agree. You know, walk a little on offense. Their other four linemen all allowed, like, three pressures each. Like,
yeah.
every single one of them. So
three is crazy for, like, one player, but for four of them is wild.
Yeah. So 12 pressures across the offensive line. None can walk a little. I think he's been, you know, the first or second best offensive player through 2 weeks. Defensively, Andre Cisco. I think he just his range and what he can do in the run, both in the running game as a tackling space and the passing game, just adds a whole new dimension for them. He, you know, maybe should have had, you know, two picks. You know, so it felt early on like he was really going to get one. And I don't need to tell you, if you know, actually, special teams, Ross Matisic. He covers punts like a linebacker. And I'm pretty sure that's why he got a shoulder injury during the preseason. He hurt it on a tackle, but
yeah,
it looks good. So, Gus, you got a hot take for me? I got
Well, first of all, just to review our hot takes from last week, I'll say a little bit of accountable, you know. I said Chris Jones will have more pressures then Kelsey has receptions. Ding, ding, ding. That was correct. Okay. You said Chris Jones will have zero sacks.
How many do you have? One and a half?
Six pressures.
I was almost right.
I think maybe 1.0 technically. Either one or one and a half. But, yeah, he definitely got at least one. My hot take for this week, though, is that the Jaguars will score 40 on the Texans, which is just like it sounds like it's about the Texans, but it's more about the Chiefs. Cause, like, basically my point is, like, again, like, my worry level is like a 2 or 3. And, like, I think a lot of the mistakes can be cleaned up. Like, I'm just even as underwhelming as Sunday was, like, now that we've had a couple of days to kind of, like, step back from it, like, I'm not really worried about the offense or team in general. So I think they're going to have a big bounce back game in week three against Houston, but especially on offense.
40 points. I want to tattoo that. I want to tattoo it to my arm. So I specifically don't forget it for next week. that is how badly I want it.
I'm not getting in your way for that.
Yeah. Okay. My hot take is, Evan Engram needs to be the focal point of the offense after I think he's been arguably the best skill player this year. He has a 76.9 success rate. That's a target, dude. That's crazy.
That is crazy.
He has 13 targets. He has fewer than Christian Kirk by four. Yeah, six fewer than Calvin Ridley. He has the same amount of targets as Zay Jones. Zay Jones has a 30. So in the same amount of targets, Zay Jones has a 38.5% success rate. You know, like Evan Engram, like that first down that he made against the Chiefs, where it felt like dude leapt like 4 yards. It perfectly showed you like why they extended him. And like I just think the offense should flow through him maybe more than it has. And has he gotten a red zone target this year? I don't think so.
And I think off the top of my head,
I think maybe that's what they were missing someday. You know, like it obviously the Chiefs were obviously, you know, focusing on Calvin Ridley and Christian Kirk in the red zone. So more Engram. That's my hot take.
Okay, yeah, I think that's a good one. His effort level has been like incredible to watch. And he's also been performing well. So that's a good take.
I'm trying to think how I can put that into a prediction.
Yeah.
Evan Engram, 250 receiving yards, 2 touchdowns over the next 3 games.
Ooh, okay. 250 receiving yards and 2 touchdowns.
Over the next three games. I know for a second you thought I was going to say 250 against the Texans.
Yeah. I was like, what the?
Yeah, no, I'm not
going to
go.
I was waiting for it. I mean, I knew you weren't going to, but I was like holding that hope that you were going to say this week against the Texans.
Yeah. I want to say, Gus, you know, my favorite thing in the press box, which it's not hard to do. There's nothing, you know, love my job, but absolutely hate the press box. But my favorite thing about the press box, Gus, in week 2 was you being like 8 seats down the row. And every time something happens that relates to a hot take, I can just be like, that's right.
The best was during the preseason when Beathard to Jones, because that hookup just like kept coming and coming. So then I would yell at you 8 seats down. But
yeah,
it's a good time.
Well, we'll save those seats. You know, well, I personally, Gus, am waiting for the Texans games at home. If they don't score 40 points, I am going to give you absolute hell, because we're bringing my hot takes back. We're going to bring yours.
Okay. I mean, okay. Chris Jones, 0 sacks with a game that he had. Like, that's
I said he was going to have a ton of pressures.
Yeah, maybe you did say that.
I hedged my bet, you know. What was it? Enough. Did it lack in genuine, you know, actual facts? Yeah. Was it credible?
You can't have both. You can't have it be like a genuine hot take or like a spicy hot take. Like,
I'll take that back. I meant the hot take, but I obviously was altering it, you know, like Play-Doh in my hand. Yeah.
You know, okay. The right way, but
coming from the guy who gets bulky balled every week. All right, well, we'll be back on Friday previewing the Houston Texans. John Shipley, Gus Logue, thank you all for joining us.